appointed. On behalf of the family of Michael Drew Dixon, I wish to thank everyone for being here today. My deepest sympathy to his mother Doris, his brother Bill, his sister Robin, and his children Michael Jr., Miles, and Meredith for your loss. My deepest sympathies. Let's open with prayer. Our loving Heavenly Father, as we meet this afternoon to remember our friend and loved one, Drew Dixon, we ask that you, Father God, we ask you for your grace, for your strength, for you to lovingly comfort our souls. Give us perspective today as we face the reality of death, as we grow in our perspective of the truths of life, and we ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I'd like to share with you the reading of Drew's obituary. Captain Michael Drew Dixon was born in Norfolk, Virginia on January 29, 1958. He attended Bayside High School and stayed very close with many of his high school friends throughout the years of his life. Drew always will be remembered for his love of Jesus Christ, his humorous personality, his strong dedication to his children, his loving nature as a sibling and a son. Drew is survived by his three children, Michael D. Dixon Jr. of New York, New York, Miles E. Dixon of Lake Park, Florida, and Meredith E. Dixon of Stevensville, Michigan. Drew also leaves behind his mother, Doris Dixon, who currently resides in Virginia Beach, along with his two older siblings, Robin Miller and Bill Dixon. Drew was preceded in death by his father, Frank W. Dixon, in 1994. We're going to open with a song, one of his favorites, In the Garden.
I come to the garden alone, while the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God discloses. And he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. I'd stay in the garden with him, though the night around me is falling, but he bids me go through the voice of hope, his voice to me is calling. Tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. And the joy we share as we tarry, ever known.
Amen. We're going to begin with eulogies, with his cousin Susie.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning, Susie.
Will you please bow your heads and pray with me? It is my honor and my great pleasure to speak here this morning. Lord, we lift this time of remembering and celebrating Drew's life up to you. May my words be uplifting and encouraging to all in attendance, especially my Aunt Doris, Bill, Robin, and Drew's children, Michael, Miles, and Meredith. In Jesus' name we pray. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Susie Cahoot. I live in Ohio, and my Aunt Doris is my father's sister. So that makes Drew my first cousin. Drew was 5 years older than me. As far as my cousins go, he was my closest in age cousin. Maybe that's why we were so close through all the years. Before I get into my thoughts about Drew, I just want to say that the entire Billette family, my parents, Uncle Harold, Annie Lynn, my siblings and their spouses, Lynn, Russ, Patty, Ed, Michael Nair, Bobby, Aida, myself, and my husband Dave, and our cousins in Florida, Suzette, Trent, and Roger, and all of our children are so very sorry for your loss. We all loved her dearly. I remember when we were really young and hearing the way my aunt and uncle spoke, saying things like, "Praise the Lord, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus." And we would always stand in a circle, hold hands, and pray as a group for the blessing of the food. This was nothing that I was used to. In fact, we used to call you guys Jesus freaks.
Jesus freaks.
It wasn't until years later that it hit me. They aren't Jesus freaks, they just love Jesus. And I know Drew loved Jesus too. When I think about Drew, I think of someone who had a big heart, someone who loved to play jokes, and I think of his smile, his blue eyes, and his courageous and his contagious laugh. I think of Drew every time I see a 7-Eleven. We used to go there and get a Coke Slurpee. I never had had a Coke Slurpee until I came to Virginia Beach. We don't have 7-Eleven. I think of deep sea fishing and when he would take me along for the day on a charter trip out of Rudy Inlet. And I think of the rec center where he worked a long time ago. I even think of Drew when I see a Kmart. Yes, I said Kmart. We were in Kmart many years ago with Drew and Sharon and my husband Dave. Drew and Dave were messing around as always with the store intercom making random announcements about blue light specials in certain aisles. So they had to outdo each other, so Drew got on the intercom and said, "Dave Cahoot, you are wanted in the lingerie aisle." We burst out laughing. Such great times. Even though we lived far from each other, we always stayed in touch with numerous phone calls throughout the year. It would always start the same, "Susie Q," and I would say, "Hey Drew, how are you?" And we would just talk about life and bring each other up to date on what was going on in our worlds. To Michael, Miles, and Meredith, I want you to know your father was so very proud of all of you. A lot of our conversations were about the three of you. Drew would just brag and tell me all the things that you guys were doing. He loved you all dearly. Finish this race of life strong. Make him proud. I know you will. So I thought it would be nice to hear what my siblings had to say about the memories of Drew. So I asked all four of them to send me something. I also asked Suzette, our cousin from Florida, if she had anything she wanted to say. So I have to read these because these are not my words, okay? So this is from my sister Lynn, who lives in Florida. On our annual summer vacations to the Outer Banks, we always stopped at Virginia Beach and stayed with Aunt Doris, Uncle Frank, Bill, Robin, and Drew. Of course, I never gave it any thought as a kid, but thank you, and God bless you, Aunt Doris, for letting our family of seven invade your home summer after summer. We would sit on the big swing down by the lake and sometimes try our hand at catching sunfish. One summer, when it was my turn with the rod, as I held it back and attempted to cast it forward, Drew yelled. I realized my hook was stuck in something, Drew's butt cheek. I think we laughed until we cried. Drew was 1 year older than me. During the school year, my mom called St. Luke's Elementary School and explained that my cousin was visiting from Virginia and would it be okay if he came to school with me. The school said yes. Imagine that. I remember I was so proud to have my cousin there with me for the whole day. What made it extra special was our lunch that day. Grandpa Belette had made some of his delicious Briar Hill pizza. And if you've never had Briar Hill pizza, you guys need to check it out. My mom wrapped up some slices in foil, and that's what Drew and I ate for lunch. I can still remember him sitting in the desk next to me. That is something I will never, ever forget. I love you, Drew. From my sister Patty, who lives in Colorado. When I think of Drew, I just always think of laughter. Thinking of him makes me smile. His care and concern for others was always obvious and admired. My memories of Cousin Drew, this is from my brother Michael, who also lives in Ohio. My cousin Drew had more charisma in his little pinky than most people have in their whole body. Everyone who knew him seems to have their favorite Drew story. This lets you know how fond people were of him. It also speaks to how many people that he touched during his life. I have many Cousin Drew stories. I love the times that we shared together. We would laugh sometimes until we cried. Good times. Whenever he called on the phone, he would say, "Hey, Michael B," and I would respond, "Hey, Drewsome." Corny, I know, but I'm going to miss those calls. Following is just one of my favorite Cousin Drew stories. Again, my brother Michael. Fishing on Lake Smith. Each summer, our family vacation growing up, we would stop in Virginia Beach and stay with Aunt Doris and Uncle Frank for a couple of days before we would go to the Outer Banks. It was a great time visiting with them and our cousins, Bill, Robin, and Drew. We would run around in the backyard and sit on the swing looking over the lake while Aunt Doris would be preparing a feast at her famous fried chicken with all the fixings. Uncle Frank would be working the grill, and we were treated to the first taste of corn on the cob of the summer. One summer after dinner, I was around 7 or 8 years old. Drew, who would have been around 11 or 12, decided to teach me how to fish. He baited my bamboo rod. Yes, it's bamboo rod. I remember those. With all things, a piece of a hot dog. Those fish were smart. They would nibble the bait, and I would see the bobber move on the water. And when I would yank the rod, the hook was picked clean. Drew put some more hot dog on the hook and told me to be patient. And when I felt a tug on the hook, to bring the rod toward me to try to set the hook. Well, the next thing I knew, I had a bite, and it bent over the bamboo rod until I thought it would snap. I was holding on, trying not to fall into the lake. Drew told me that this was a big one. He held on to me from behind and told me, "Don't let go." Well, with Drew's help, I landed a 3-pound bass. Drew was so proud of his young cousin. He paraded me around the neighborhood with the fish in hand, and he would knock on neighbors' doors and tell them that his cousin from Ohio caught the fish. That night, I heard my name on the local fishing report on TV. The announcer was surprised as he read that the fish was caught using a piece of hot dog as bait. Drew made me feel special. He had that knack of always making people feel special in his presence. Love you, Jerusalem. This is from my brother Bobby, who lives in Florida. To begin, it is with deep regret that I am offered to share my reflection of my awesome cousin Drew Dixon. I've been thinking of Drew daily, as I'm sure we all have. And when I was asked if I would share my memories, I started thinking. While in reflection, the one thing that kept pushing to the front of my thoughts was that Drew was a great cousin. That simple. Then I decided to enrich my understanding of the word cousin. I would like to share its meaning. Cousin, a child of one's uncle or aunt. A person belonging to the same extended family. Drew always represented to me what a cousin was meant to be. That is, a person belonging to the same extended family. I would always look forward to that moment when my first cousin would one by one arrive I always look forward to that moment when my first cousins would one by one arrive at Uncle Frank and Aunt Doris's home. I knew my family was here. Drew, for me, always made sure I felt included and not left out, being I was the youngest. He always made me and my brother and sisters feel welcomed and loved. His great gift and constant playful, upbeat demeanor was so enticing. We couldn't wait to see our family in Virginia Beach and always waited for that one day in the week at the Outer Banks when they would come down and spend the day. As you see, we've all mentioned the Outer Banks because it was just such a special time. When I moved to Florida initially, Drew and Sharon, without hesitation, invited me to stay in their condo in Stuart, where I stayed a year. Drew, true to form, made me feel welcome and loved, like a cousin would love to feel. He was and is awesome. I love you, Cousin Drew. I will dearly miss you. Thank you for sharing your love and family values with me. You truly have made lasting memories that I will hold dear to me for the rest of my life. I love you, Cousin Bobby. And Suzette, our first cousin on my Aunt Doris's brother's side. Drew was a good soul, lovable and kind. We always had a good time with him, and I'm so sorry that he had to leave everyone so soon. May he be in peace now and be remembered lovingly by all who knew him. Please give Aunt Doris, Bill, and Robin a big hug from us. So in closing, I want to tell one more story about my Uncle Frank. 24 years ago, and that really seems impossible, my Uncle Frank knew he was losing his battle with cancer, and we decided to make the drive from Ohio to go and see him one last time, my parents and Dave and I. I remember it like it was yesterday. We arrived at Virginia Beach thinking we were there to console my aunt, my uncle, and his family, and he ended up consoling us. Uncle Frank called us into his living room. I remember there was a fire burning in the fireplace. He sat us all down and read Psalm 23. And he told us not to be sad. He told us not to cry for him. He said he knew the Lord and he knew he would be spending his eternity with Jesus. We were all crying, and then he started to read. So today I would like to read Psalms 23 to you. Drew is rejoicing in heaven. He's with his earthly father. A man he dearly loved, he is also with his heavenly father. This is Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not be in want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, no evil. For you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Thank you. Drew, we will see you again.
Thank you. this, I promise.
Good afternoon.
When I consider thy heavens, the work of thy fingers, the moon and the stars which thou hast ordained, what is man that thou art mindful of him, and the son of man that thou visitest him? For thou hast made him a little lower than the angels, and has crowned him with glory and honor. Thou madest him to have dominion over the works of thy hands. Thou hast put all things under his feet, all sheep and oxen, yea, and the beasts of the field, and the fowl of the air, and the fish of the sea, and whatsoever passes through the paths of the seas. Lord, O Lord, how excellent is thy name in all the earth. Now, having a sister is a wonderful thing, no doubt. They make great targets for sighting your BB gun, or testing the casting range on your brand new treble hook shyster lure flung from your trusty Zebco spinning outfit down by the lake in the backyard. Sisters are great to have around for a kid like me growing up. But a little brother, that might be even better, because you have a ready-made slave. I mean, somebody you can tell what to do, you can pick on, you can boss around without any fear or retaliation at all. Well, except maybe for that time he stole all the cantaloupes that I had planned to sell at my Kool-Aid stand by the street in the front yard, and he loaded them all into Robin's baby buggy and carried them up and down the neighborhood, selling them off one by one to the neighbors. He even kept all the money. Oh, I protested, no doubt, but Dad, he didn't want to hear it. And then there was that time that he and his pesky little friends decided to camp out one night down by the lake. And they also decided that my boat that I had built by myself when I was 13 years old would be the perfect fuel for their campfire that night. But there was that one time that it was really good. I didn't know it was him when I came walking home one afternoon, and he had egged my boat, my 19-foot Thunderbird with the 125 horsepower outboard motor sitting on the trailer in the front yard. I walked up, and there was eggs dripping off the side, off the windshield, off the motor cowling, down the curtains. I was seething mad. I came into the house, and I'm just screaming, and who egged my boat? Well, Mom and Dad knew who egged it, because there was a certain lacking in the number of eggs in the carton the next morning when Mom went to prepare breakfast. But they even took him into protective custody and let the whole thing remain a mystery to me until somewhere around my 40th birthday. Hey, if there's one thing I've come to learn about little brothers, they got it easy. They get away with murder. They didn't. For my entire youth living at home, I had to mow our nearly half-acre yard twice a week in the summertime with a push mower. Drew, he didn't even have to pull a weed. When I finally left home and moved out and the yard mowing chores were passed on to Drew, Dad bought a riding lawnmower. A riding lawnmower. I don't think I ever got over that. I'm still not over that. But even little brothers get busted once in a while, and don't you just love it when they do? Like the time Drew was, I don't know, 14, maybe 15 years old, he and some of his friends in the neighborhood decided to pilfer some beer from someone's parents' icebox. Now, it seems this same group enjoyed tormenting the English bulldog that was penned up behind the chain link fence in the neighbors next door in their front yard. A bit of a curious thing, because Drew was always terrified of dogs. Anyway, late that evening, following their beer drinking foray, Drew slipped stealthily up the walk. His plan was to climb up the wrought iron post that supported the porch overhang, the roof, slither up over the roof, and climb into his bedroom window undetected if it was above. So Drew's sneaking up the wall. And all of a sudden, sitting there, basking in the glow from the streetlight, was that English bulldog on the front porch. But here's the twist. Back in those days, if Drew had had a little bit too much to drink, he was prone to seeing double. So from his perspective, there wasn't one bulldog on the porch, but two. And they came sailing down the steps, barking and growling, snarling white teeth, reflecting the beam of the streetlight, and chased Drew up the deer door tree that was in the front yard. Well, the dog held Drew at bay in the tree just long enough for the porch light to flash on, revealing Dad swinging open the front door. Busted. He was busted big time. Now, I don't know, my memory's a little fuzzy right here. I don't know if he just went ahead and let that dog hold Drew at bay in that tree the rest of the night, or if he actually let him come on down, shoot a dog off, and let him come in the house. But one thing's for certain, he lived on to get his driver's license. Now, Dad had this big old green Oldsmobile 98, and he had bought a new Mercury, but he was holding on to that car because that was going to be the car he'd let Drew drive. But there were some rules. Drew was not allowed to drive it unless Dad knew where he was going and who was going to be in the car with him. Well, one afternoon, Dad was off shooting pictures. He was a school photographer. He was off shooting pictures. And Drew decided that it would be the perfect opportunity and time to give Doug Lane down the street driving lessons. So they climb in the car, Drew on the passenger side, Doug seated behind the wheel, and went cruising down Aragon Boulevard in our neighborhood. And they're driving along, and all of a sudden there's an oncoming vehicle coming towards them on the street. Oh crap, Doug, it's Dad, Doug. So they both ducked down behind the dashboard, thinking they were going to go cruising along undetected. There's Dad. Obviously recognize that that's his Oldsmobile 98, apparently cruising on past driverless. When Drew and Doug, you remember this.
Oh yeah, I remember.
Yeah, you remember. Drew and Doug finally mustered up enough courage to go home, and they were met with Dad standing in the front yard with outstretched palm. He didn't have to say a word. Drew deposited the keys. But then, somehow, little brothers morphed from being a total pain in the butt into becoming your best friend. And so it was with mine. You become partners in crime and exploits and fun. You become roommates. Drew decided he wanted to get into the crabbing business along with Mike Tomko, another friend from the neighborhood. And I sold him my flat-bottom Juniper skiff with a 35-horsepower Evinrude on the back, along with all my crab pots. Now, Drew, I had sold all my crabs wholesale, mostly to Dave Davis at the D&M Marina, but Drew decided he could make more money if he would sell his retail. So being the marketing genius that he was, he devised a plan whereby the customers would come to him. So he painted big red letters down both sides of the boat. And he'd get his crabs, they board his pots that morning, and they're all basket up there, and he cruise up and down Long Creek and Lynn Haven Inlet, and on the side of his boat, the letters read, "I've got the crabs." Well, of course, amused folks on the water wave him over, and they go to him, and needless to say, Drew's crabs quickly sold out. Well, then he wanted to learn how to fish, so he got a job on some head boats. I know he worked for Captain Linwood Martin's on the Rainbow. And then he got a job as a mate on a 53-foot Hatteras, the Clam Digger. Now, one day, Dick Myers wanted Drew to change the oil in the big Detroit diesel engines, and Drew decided that was a little bit of a project that he wasn't too sure he wanted to take on by himself, so he enlisted me to help. So it was because of that I met Dick Myers. And from that introduction to Dick, Drew got me my very first full-time job as a private sport fishing yacht captain. My little brother had gotten me into the big time. Those were just the sort of people skills that he possessed. Well, after hunting season that fall, we were off on a whole new adventure, steaming the Clam Digger south of Florida along with Dick and Mary Myers and George Lyon, who was the first time I'd ever met. George and I have come to be lifelong friends, and I know he's a very dear, cherished friend of mine. So anyway, we cruised that winter. We cruised to the Bahamas and spent much of the following that winter and spring living first aboard the boat in the Florida Keys, and then moving into a duplex that was on the property there that was owned by Dick and Mary in Key Colony Beach. By this time, Drew had the same girlfriend from back here in Virginia Beach for quite a few years, Sharon. And she was staying with her dad up in Homestead. Sharon would come down often to visit us in the Keys, and on one such occasion, Sharon and Drew were having some kind of a lover's quarrel, a spat, something going on, and they weren't speaking to each other. They went the whole day without speaking. Well, Drew and I shared the same room in the house where there was a double bed, a single bed, and an adjoining bathroom. And we always enjoyed playing tricks on Sharon. Drew and I turned in for the night, and Sharon was taking a shower. And Drew and I decided this was going to be the perfect opportunity to play another one. So we switched beds. It was dark. Sharon comes out of the shower. She comes and gets in the bed where she thought Drew was. She climbs in, and unsuspectingly, I put my arm around her and kind of gave her a little kiss on the back of the neck. She's like, "Okay, he wants to make up. That's cool." So she started cozying a little bit. About that time, she heard Drew snicker and laughter from across the room. She bristled up, stiff as a board, catapulted out of the bed, across the floor, feet never touching the ground, landed on top of Drew over there, but by now was just roaring with laughter. For Sharon, I don't think she ever really fully recovered from that. And then there was that same year that Sister Robin decided to come visit us in the Keys and brought Jesse, who wasn't even but about a month old then. And she had to run to the store. You know, women, they always got to run to the store, and left Jesse, baby Jesse, in the care and custody of me and Drew. Well, she returned to find Jesse sound asleep in his car seat on the counter in the galley of the Clam Digger, clutching one of Mary Myers' bottles of Seagram's VO with a nipple on top. Mom saw the picture that we took. I can't believe that you boys would do that to that baby. I said, "Mom, we didn't really do anything to the baby. We just took a picture. Of course, we didn't let him drink the VO. We gave him his baby's formula." Well, later that evening, we all decided to climb into the El Camino and go to the Buccaneer for dinner. Now, y'all know what an El Camino is, I guess. It's kind of like a little wannabe pickup truck, a car with a bed in the back and just one long bench seat in the front. So here I'm driving, I'm behind the wheel. We got little Jesse in his car seat, Robin and Drew. It's kind of tight in there, but it's okay. So we go have dinner, and on the way back, guess who's got to stop at the store? This time for diapers. So we pull up to the U-Totem convenience store there, just before the causeway, going over to the island. Drew goes in, and that time of night, there wasn't, the parking lot was pretty empty. And all of a sudden, there was a roar. This motorcycle gang comes pulling up all around us, vroom, vroom. Motors blaring, they were screaming, rowdy bunch. Drew opens his door, gets out, walks around the front of the car, puts his foot up on the bumper, leans back, takes a big drag off his cigarette, and flicks it right into the middle of this motorcycle gang. I'm looking. Couldn't believe it. So I reach into the side pocket of the door, grab hold of a billy club that I kept there, because I wasn't going to let him die alone out there. Well, that motorcycle gang, they just all froze. Awestruck expressions on their faces. 24 eyes gazing, piercing at Drew. I want y'all to turn those bikes off and shut up. My nephew's asleep on the front seat of the car and you're going to wake him up. They're all looking at each other, and what appears to be the gang member turns around and says, looks at Drew and says, "Sure, man, we're sorry." Drew said, "Thank you." Came back and got in the car. I said, "If you ever pull another crazy stunt like that, I'm going to kill you myself." Following year, I became captain of George Lyon's new boat, the Tranquil, and I hired Drew to be my mate. We took George's boat to Florida in the fall, and after getting things squared away at Sailfish Marina, Drew and I flew back to Virginia Beach and prepared to leave for the mountains on our annual hunting trip to the mountains, the cabin with Bruce and Tom and David and Keith who were back there and all the rest of the guys would come up there. And of course, Doug Lane, remember driving lesson Doug, he came along. Now, Drew loved to hunt, except that he never really did hunt. He wouldn't stay on the stand more than 15 minutes. So one afternoon, Doug and Drew decided they needed to carry the garbage up to the dumpsters that were out on Route 39. And they hadn't been gone very long when they come pulling back down the lane and up to the cabin. I'm looking out the window. There's a deer tied on the hood of the car. What? I walk out, "What? Drew, what the heck? Who got the deer?" Drew says, "Well, we were putting the trash in the dumpster, and this deer leaped out of it and hit the ground and died right there at her feet."
What?
Apparently he had been wounded by another hunter and it made his way to the bluff that was a little bluff that was overlooking where the dumpsters were and stumbled in and fell and Drew and Doug threw the trash in, startled the deer and he jumped out. I'll guarantee you one of this. Nobody's got a better first deer story than Drew's. Of course, Drew and Sharon went on to get married. They had Michael and Miles and Meredith. And he got his 100-ton license after working a while as a mate aboard the legendary Annabeth with the legendary Captain Mike Finch, who so many of us in this room all affectionately remember as Captain Finko. And Drew became a captain in his own right, running not only Bruce Gottwall Jr.'s Viking sport fishing yacht Kimberly, but their summer home and Kim's Island, their whole operation on Baldhead Island, too. And then, of course, there was his boatyard that he had on Southport. Drew was a great captain. He was a devoted father to Michael, Miles, and Meredith. And he stayed in contact with them pretty much every day right up to the end. And oh, how Drew loved his daddy. And oh, how his daddy loved him. Dad always had this little extra tender spot in his heart for Drew. It's said that a mother's love is endless and knows no boundaries. Such is the case with Mom and Drew. You had all the best intentions, all the chances, all the second chances, all the third chances. You never gave up. And we love you for that. And Drew loved his mom. Drew loved his sister Robin. He even loved me. He loved his aunts and his uncles and his cousins, and his nieces and nephews too. Drew loved his friends. And you know who else Drew loved? He loved Jesus. Yes, he did. And oh, how we all loved him. Everybody loved Drew. Fair winds and following seas. Captain Drew. Little brother. You made us laugh. You made us cry. You even made us mad. But there's one thing that you have made us perhaps the most. Drew, you've made us aware of the need for redemption in all of our own selves. And now you finally have yours. July 4th, 2018 was truly Drew's day of independence. When angels swung that sweet chariot low that early Wednesday morning to carry him home. And of this I have no doubt. Like the Apostle Paul stated in Romans 8:38 and 39. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Rest in his arms now, little brother. His peace has finally found you.
I could see angels' faces.
when they hear your sweet voice sing. So go rest high on that mountain, son, your work on earth is done. Go to heaven a shout, love for the Father.
We're all shocked by the news of Drew's death because we assumed that he still had more time. The Bible reminds us, however, that life is uncertain and even fleeting. In James chapter 4, verses 13 to 14, it says, "Now listen to me, you that say, today or tomorrow we will travel to a certain city where we will stay a year and go into business and make a lot of money. You don't even know what your life tomorrow will be. You are like a puff of smoke which appears for a moment, then disappears." Drew's death reminds us that we dare not presume about our own future. We have only the present moment to serve God and our neighbors. The future is uncertain and life is fleeting. Perhaps you've come expecting some kind of explanation from God. Why? If God were not a God of love, we would have no need for an explanation. If God were not sovereign, we could explain Drew's death as something which was not God's will, but was simply beyond his ability to control. But Drew's faith in God is both good and he is great. So to honor Drew and his love for God, I want to share who Drew put his unwavering faith in, and that was Jesus Christ. The Trinity makes up the Godhead: God the Father, God the Son, Jesus Christ, and God the Holy Spirit. Jesus has always existed as God the Son. It was Jesus who was there in the beginning, from the very beginning, who created everything we see and everything we do not see. Then Adam and Eve made one decision. That changed a perfect world to a sinful world. No work or sacrifice or amount of good deeds could pay the price for that sinful decision in that garden. We cannot remove our own sins. God is the only one who can remove and forgive sin. Because of that sinful decision made in the garden, the only thing that can be done was for God the Son, Jesus, to leave his throne in heaven, his glory, and come to earth and take on the form of man so that he could become one of us and pay the cost for the sin that we are unable to pay. Because it required a perfect and holy sacrifice. I mean, who here is perfect? Only Christ, and that's why it's only Christ who could pay that price. This is why Jesus came to earth, to die as a perfect sacrifice so you, I, Drew, can be with God in heaven for eternity. Jesus offers the free opportunity for eternal life. You only have to believe in Jesus Christ, that he paid the price for your sin, for my sin. And this hope of everlasting life is a free gift, paid by the body and blood of Jesus Christ. Why would he do that? Because God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son. And anyone who believes in him, anyone who asks Jesus Christ to be your Lord and Savior, will have eternal life. Drew has left this natural physical world, what we see, and he's now in eternity, what we cannot see. In other words, when the eternal comes, it overtakes what is temporary. One reason why people struggle so much is because we value so much in the things that we can see. Yet we fail to recognize that everything that we see, everything that is around us, is temporary. You're not taking it with you. What we cannot see is eternal. And the way to access the things that are eternal is by faith, which is a free gift. So, whatever that you are going through right now, it is temporary. Your sickness is temporary. Your bondage is temporary. Your poverty is temporary. Your mental issues are temporary. Your addiction is temporary. Because all of the issues we deal with in life are temporary. It's temporary, yes. Because God has the ability to change it here on earth. But we also know that it's temporary because none of the issues that we deal with we take into eternity. In Revelation chapter 21, verse 4, it says, God will wipe away every, not some, not just certain places where you suffer or deal with things. He says he will wipe away every tear from your eyes. And death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore, for the former things have passed away. They're temporary. They will pass away. Because they are temporary. That can be difficult for some, especially if you're carrying issues in your life, illnesses in your body, and you wonder, and maybe you've even asked God, when am I going to be delivered from this? When is my pain? When is my suffering? When is this thing that I struggle with? When is it going to end? So we pray for healing. But I trust God's word. I trust his word that he heals people eternally. Either here on earth, so that people here on earth will see God's eternal power and seek to know him more, or you will be eternally healed when you make it to heaven, where death shall be no more, because death in itself is temporary. To a believer, death is a graduation. A believer's death is his or her coronation day. It is his or her marriage day. It is a rest from sin. It is a rest from sorrow. It is a rest from afflictions and temptations. Death to a believer is an entrance into the fullness of the Lord's love and joy, where grace is swallowed up in his glory. Death delivers us once and for all from every bondage in this world. Thanks be to Jesus Christ. Thank you, Jesus. We must be prepared to stand before a righteous God, who will either be our judge or he will be our Savior. That's a choice we have to make here. And how joyful is it for Drew to now stand in the presence of God because he trusted Jesus as his Savior. But what if it were you, my friend? What if it were you who had died? What would be your response to God? Judge or Savior? The Apostle Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 50 through 58. He says, "What I am saying, dear brothers and sisters, is that our physical bodies cannot inherit the kingdom of God. These dying bodies cannot inherit what will last forever. But let me reveal to you a wonderful secret. We will not all die, but we will be transformed. It will happen in a moment, in the blink of an eye, when the last trumpet is blown. For when the trumpet sounds, those who have died will be raised to live forever, and we who are living will also be transformed. For our dying bodies must be transformed into bodies that will never die. Our mortal bodies must be transformed into immortal bodies. Then, when our dying bodies have been transformed into bodies that will never die, this scripture will be fulfilled. Death is swallowed up in victory. Oh, death, where is your victory? Oh, death, where is your sting? For sin is the sting that results in death, and the law gives sin its power. But thank God, he gives us victory over sin and death through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So, my dear brothers and sisters, be strong and immovable. Always work enthusiastically for the Lord, for you know that nothing you do for the Lord is ever useless. Nothing you do for the Lord is ever useless. When a person does not have saving faith in Jesus Christ, death is a dreaded foe to be avoided as long as possible. For the Christian, death is not a dreaded foe, but a defeated enemy. I am certain that in this service, there are some who see death only as a defeated enemy, and yet there are also some who see death as a dreaded enemy as well. I urge you, as Drew may have already done, to put your trust and faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, so that even in the death of our friend and loved one, we may glorify God and know that Drew's desire is that when the Lord returns, you'll be there too. So let me ask you a question. Do you believe? Do you have faith in Jesus? Or do you have faith in your own good deeds and good works? As generous of a person that Drew was, he understood that no amount of good works would gain him access into heaven. That Jesus did all of the work, and heaven only comes by a way of faith in Christ. The Bible says that if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes and is justified, and with the mouth one confesses and is saved. If you realize your need for Christ, allow me to lead you in a prayer right now. Will you pray with me? Dear Jesus, my life is broken. I recognize my brokenness is because of my own sin. I need you, Jesus. I believe Jesus came to live, die, and was raised from the dead to rescue me from my sin. Forgive me, Lord. I turn from my selfish ways, and I put my trust in you, Jesus. I know that Jesus is Lord of all, and I will follow him. Amen. If you prayed that prayer in faith for the first time, the best news I can give you today, the best news for your entire life, is that you will see Drew again. Hallelujah. Let me share another one of Drew's favorite songs, As the Dew. Such a loving person. His people skills were superior. He was a joy to be around. You heard many stories that made us all laugh about his infectious smile, his laugh, his humor. He loved sharing stories about being a boating captain. He was full of knowledge of boats and yachts, and his love for being out of the water was very evident. Drew loved the outdoors, he loved fishing, hunting, and he loved to cook. I just wish I could have sampled some of those dishes, you know? That low country boil, man, that's speaking to me. And I also hear that drinking coffee and smoking cigarettes in a tree stand equals no deer. Like, you will not catch a deer while drinking coffee and smoking a cigarette. It actually repels deer. So if that's your goal, then feel free to bring those things as well. As a young boy, Drew had his charisma and beginning business skills at work, where he got other kids in the neighborhood and he taught them how to stand on their head, of course, for a nickel a lesson. So he was a good entrepreneur. And one year I heard he took, after his birthday party, he took all of his gifts and he resold them. I hear for a profit. But it also went without saying that Drew was a very giving person. Very giving. In fact, he loved to spoil his children at Christmas time, from buying each of them a four-wheeler, to allowing Michael to drive up the water bill by spraying the roof with water until icicles formed. Drew was always up to something fun. And it was very important to Drew that the people in his presence had a good time. Drew never met a stranger. He'd talk to anyone, even in his sleep. You can hear him talking in his sleep. I first met Drew right up here on the front lawn. I believe my family and I, we were changing the church sign out there, and Drew walks by, going west here on Norfolk Avenue, and he was going to the junior market right across the street. And as he just kind of walked, and he just kind of looked and just kind of stopped, just almost like waiting to make eye contact with me. And then once we did, he smiled at me. And then he kept walking, so I smiled back, of course. And then he goes to the junior market, and he comes back, and he's got a bag. And he slows down again, and he looks at me. And I said, "Hi, how are you doing?" And he said, He introduced himself, and he asked what time church services were. And the next thing I know, Drew shows up on a Wednesday night Bible study back here in the fellowship hall, where everyone is invited to join us after this service. And then he showed up again and again. And then I'd see him on Sundays, sitting about halfway down on the inside aisle, about right there. And I'd always go by and ask him, "How are you doing?" "I'm doing okay. It was a good day today. How can I pray for you, Drew?" And he'd tell me how his family's doing. He'd tell me about his mother. And honestly, I cannot recall one conversation where he didn't get choked up talking about his family and his faith in Jesus Christ. "I heard most about you, Miss Dorothy." Drew showed me how a child loves a parent. He loved you. He cried every time he talked about you. Through the ups and downs, through the triumphs and tragedies, without a doubt, Drew Dixon loved his family. Drew also spoke of his love for his children. "I don't think there was anything he wouldn't do for any one of you. From spoiling you to a story I just heard last night where there was a winter storm and the power went out and it was freezing cold, and he grabbed his son and he protected him from the harsh elements and from freezing to death. To another story I heard last night where someone who wasn't even his own child, risked his own life jumping out of the boat as the captain of the boat to go save a child who was caught in the current, risking his own life for someone else's child. He must have had an oversized heart to contain all that love that he has for all of you. Sometimes we cry over things that we wish we did different. Drew only spoke of two things that he wishes he did different. He talked about his failed marriage, and he wishes that would have been different. And kicking alcohol out once and for all. He struggled with those two. What we can learn and carry on from Drew is to have passion for the things we are really good, that are really good. Have passion for the things that are really good, like family, like helping other people. I mean, if there's something that you can do different, then do it. Love your family. And what a peace it brings to us, knowing that Drew is in the care of Christ and reunited with his father, Frank. Drew had a real faith in God, and you can too, because God is good. Even on a day like today, we can still say, God is good. And if you're here dealing with things you wish you could have done different, I would ask you to do just this one thing. Forgive yourself, because God is willing to forgive you. Forgive yourself. Drew battled with some difficult times, some powerful demons, but Drew knew who to turn to for help: Jesus. And that is the good that you can learn and take away from Drew's life. When troubling times come in life, will you turn to Jesus? If you need hope for a fresh start, allow these words from Philippians chapter 3 to encourage you. Now, dear brothers and sisters, I have not achieved it, but I focus on this one thing: forgetting the past and looking forward to what lies ahead. I press on to reach the end of the race and receive the heavenly prize for which God, through Jesus Christ, is calling us. Jesus is still calling every single one of us. Let me close with these thoughts. I pray that your grief can be comforted with thanksgivings to God for the wonderful times that you had with Drew. As we consider this assembly gathered here today, there is a wonderful hope for all of us to go with Christ, to go with Drew, if we remain faithful. We share with you your tears in parting for your loved one, Drew Dixon, but I also hope that we will share with you the joys of meeting Drew again. Amen. The song Amazing Grace is going to play now, and if you feel so led to sing along, the words will be on the screen.
Amazing grace, how sweet.
Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, inasmuch as you and your sovereign love have called the soul of our loved one and friend Drew to be with you, we express our thanks for the privilege of knowing him. We thank you for the way he impacted our lives and for your grace through difficult times. We are grateful for your love. You alone are worthy of our faith. To you we turn for continued strength, continued comfort, continued perspective, and continued purpose. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. The family is asking that you join them in the fellowship hall for a meal, and if we could have the family go first.